Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the last and final session of Breaking Intimidation. This is session 8. It's been a long one. I think that probably in the future I don't know about y'all, but waiting every 2 weeks is a little bit of a stretch. I think that, I don't know, what do you think, Sue and Rachel and Frank? I think it stretches out a bit much, and I don't even remember what we talked about 2 weeks ago. So
I agree with you.
Yeah, I think 1 week to week would be a little bit better. We may adjust the times and the day or whatever to try and suit everybody's needs, but at the end of the day, it'll probably have to be around my schedule, unfortunately, because I'm the one that's having to conduct all this, So we'll figure out something that works well. And the next session or the next study will be a little bit different and won't be as structured as John Bevere, so it'll be a lot more interaction and discussion from y'all, and the next one will be all scripture based, all based around three dynamic principles of identity, authority, and influence, and how those correlate to the scripture, both in the negative and the positive. So it'll be a pretty good study. Before we get started, is there any prayer requests or praise reports? Yep.
Well, they might start our water next Tuesday, but they have to bore under the highway, so mm-hmm. they have to get so many people to, you know. I don't know.
Do they have to sign off on it or something?
Yeah, they have to do it when they can do it, sheriff's office, all that stuff, because it's a county road or a highway, I don't know. But,
Good deal.
It's moving.
Yeah. They'll do some horizontal drilling for that. And, yeah, they'll have to probably stop traffic for that. So, but we pray that it goes well and you don't have to, you're not delayed anymore. I know that you guys are ready to get this show on the road and get in there. And, that's probably an understatement, huh?
Something else. Well, they're working on getting the permits for getting all the lights and all that stuff done with the transformer and all that stuff too. It's moving. Praise God for that. You know, he's working in it. He's already, you know, he's been working this whole time, you know, everything. So just behind the scenes.
Good deal. We just, like I said, we just pray that that everything goes smoothly and quickly. Expedited. So, anybody else?
Did Ashley go to the hospital, Rachel, today?
No, ma'am. We took her to urgent care. She got the medicine that she needed and everything.
Okay.
It was a lot quicker.
Okay, good.
Urgent care.
But she's doing okay. She's just at home.
Okay.
Good. We continue to pray for her too. I know that she's battling some things. Is she getting any headway or is it just?
She just said she's just been getting worse. That's why she wanted to go.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Anybody else? I've got a couple. So please keep. This young girl, many of you may have heard of her. Her name's Malia. She's 15. She's from Crestview, dealing with brain cancer. She is the younger sister of Lena's boyfriend. They don't know how much longer she has. It's kind of one of those things, you know. So we just ask that we keep praying for the family and that whenever her transition is, that it would be smooth and, you know, and the Lord would be available to, or that he would be with the entire family as they go through this time. I know that his mom is, or Malia's mom is constantly taking care of her. And it's a lot. I mean, I can't imagine, you know, just taking care of your child, waiting, you know, knowing the inevitable, but it's gotta be difficult. Also, I have a meeting tomorrow night. Oh, let's let Diane come in. Good Good evening, Nithil. We're just taking some prayer requests and praise reports. We were just praying for Rachel and her health situation, all that go through, and then I was just asking that we would continue to pray for Lena's boyfriend Mason. His younger sister Malia is the one that's battling brain cancer, and she's, I think they said maybe this month, and then maybe next month. It could be a long time, but she's just constantly battling brain cancer, and his mom, you know, constantly taking care of her and always there, and it's a lot. So we just ask that we would keep Malia in your prayers. And then also, I was saying when you came in, Diane, that if y'all can just keep me in your prayers tomorrow night. I have a meeting tomorrow night that is, I'm trying to figure out the best way to put it. It's very, very critical.
Yes.
And it has to do with another organization that I'm currently a part of. We'll see how that continues to play forward. Many of you have been on the prayer chain for this organization, and there are some major, major decisions that need to be made, and I'm just praying that I can keep my composure and keep my Christianity in check, because sometimes,
yeah.
We'll just leave it at that. Anybody else?
What's Mason's sister's name?
Malia, Maleia, I believe is her name, Malia Spears.
How old is she?
Malia is 15.
Goodness.
Yes. And she has an uncurable brain cancer, and she's bedridden right now, oxygen, feeding tube. I think they've got enough medicine to keep her kind of, you know, comfortable.
Comfortable.
It's just one of those things you don't know when. And we took him with us this weekend and had a great time. So, and then Lena went over there today to spend time with her and his mom, and brought them flowers and just stuff like that. So it's a huge thing, you know.
Did they live there in Baker or Crestview?
No, they live in Crestview. It's kind of ironic that, so the house that Don and Angie bought, they bought from this family. And
oh, really?
Yeah, Malcolm Spears is the one that built the house. So he has a construction firm. He builds houses. And Malcolm built that house. So, like, Don and Angie know Mason and Malia and all of them. They have property next to Craig and Sarah. So they've known them since they were little. So good, good family. So, but having to go through, you know, kind of watching all that is difficult. So, yeah. Anybody else? Any more prayer requests or praise reports?
Sister White's family, the Carolyn Brown family, the funeral was today.
Oh, okay.
So keep them lifted up. There's some family situations too that's going on too through all of this. So,
mm-hmm. Did you guys go today?
We did.
Oh, you did? How was it? Good?
It was really good. It was really good.
Yeah, I didn't even know when. I didn't know when the service was.
Carolyn was a sweetheart.
Yeah. I remember meeting her once or twice.
So yeah, we spent a lot of time at the hospital 9 years ago when she had the gallbladder surgery, and then they nicked her, did whatever, and poisoned her whole system.
Yeah.
You know, but we spent, gosh, days and days, because she was in the hospital for 81 days, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, but the Lord used that to minister to her son, Vince, and Connie,
mm-hmm.
and Hannah. Now, Hannah used to be a part of the youth group at Milligan back in that day, too.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so we kind of drew close to that family 9 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, we kind of went our ways, but it was good to be back with them, you know, and
mm-hmm.
we'll just see where the Lord goes with it.
Yeah,
but,
absolutely.
Yep.
Well, that's a smooth transition, hopefully. And now that she ain't got to deal with this stuff no more.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, there's a a wayward daughter that's creating some issues. So, and Vince and Connie's not where they need to be in the Lord either. So,
now, is Vince, is that her brother? That's not the guy that was coming to church, was it?
They were. You're talking about Ricky? Her brother, Ricky. You're talking about Ricky.
That's Ricky, yeah.
Vince is really her Sister White's cousin.
Oh, okay.
Her biological mother never really had anything to do with her, so Carolyn just took her up under her wing and was the mom to her.
Yeah.
But yeah, we got to talk to Ricky too, so that's good. Lift Ricky up too, because he's kind of fell off the bandwagon per se, so we're going to try to work on him.
Yeah. All right, anybody else?
Yeah, please remember Bridget, Benjamin and Bridget.
Mm-hmm.
I see Bridget right now.
Okay. We'll just
go through some stuff.
Leave it unspoken for sure. So, okay. Go ahead, Rachel.
Can you keep my husband in your prayers, Justin, with his dad and the situation there?
Okay. Absolutely. I know Frank's listening. We'll continue to keep his brother in prayer too, who's battling cancer. And still probably your son-in-law's mother, is she still fighting?
Yeah, she's still battling that, yeah.
Okay. Ready? We got most of them? Alrighty. Well, on another note, something a little bit more positive. Oh, by the way, I got 5 backpacks on the way. 4 of them should be here, I think, this week, and then I gotta wait for one next week, which is for the little girl, but then we'll have one.
Okay, good, because I got all the other supplies per se. I need a thing here or there.
Yeah. And I went and ordered, like, I didn't buy the cheap ones. I got some decent ones, and
yeah,
all different colors, you know, so they're not all the same, but 4 of the kids are high school kids. So anyway, for those who are on here that are listening, so we partnered with High Praise Church in Crestview. They were doing a back to school event, sponsoring children who need back to school supplies and stuff like that. And then they're not coming from anywhere. They're just, those will be, they're families that really have a need. I think there was us, and I want to say there was 8 or 9 other partners that partnered with them. And we picked up 5 kids, and Diane went and got all the supplies according to their school for all those kids. And we bought backpacks, and we'll pack all that stuff up and get that to the church. I think it's the end of July we have to have it to them. Anyway, that's something we did. And while I was looking yesterday, Diane, there was a thing I saw. So for like $240 on Amazon, you could buy 24 backpacks with supplies in them. Of course, the supplies are, you know, it's probably like your basic supplies. And of course, every school has a different supplies list. But I thought, I was like, man, that's a lot. Now, they probably aren't the greatest quality stuff. But I mean, you know, in that given situation, you know, I mean, 24 backpacks was a lot. I thought, well, maybe next time around we can do something like that. But
maybe
we are continually trying to partner with other ministries and stuff to do stuff like this, because, you know, we believe that, you know, you can't do it all by yourself, and there ain't no sense in reinventing the wheel. It's just help other people. I mean, that's the whole part of being the body of Christ, is it's you work together. So if somebody else is doing it, then just help them out. That simple. So.
Amen.
But. All right, we'll get started. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to come together, and we lift up all these prayers to you today, Lord, all the spoken and the unspoken prayers. You've heard them all. Lord, you know the ones that have not been spoken. You know our hearts, Lord, and we come to you willingly. We come to your feet and lay them at your feet, Lord. We ask that you would minister to these needs that we have, whether they be physical needs or financial needs or spiritual needs, whatever they may be. We just ask that you would minister to those quickly, Lord. We on credit right now, we give you praise for those things. We lift up the families who have lost loved ones and that are dealing with this season of loss. We lift them up. Lord, we just thank you for this time. Ask that we would get into your word and study it well. Pray that we would receive all that John has for us through you. And we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody may be joining. I don't know.
Heidi's supposed to be.
Huh?
Heidi is supposed to be joining.
She's busy.
Yeah, she is. I see.
Okay. She'll get it later.
She just responded to me, so yeah.
She's taking care of something.
Yep.
All right. So I'm gonna try and I don't know if I can summarize, but I will try to go through this fairly quickly. I think the biggest thing, so the basis of this entire study is one verse, which is 1 Timothy, oh my gosh, I can't find it. It is 2 Timothy 1:7 is actually what it is. And I'll read it real quick out of the New King James. And it says this. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of sound mind. So this whole entire study is pretty much based on that scripture alone. We've gone from session one. It was talking about exposing the intimidation, knowing your enemy, and how to correctly wage war with them. Operating in your God-given authority, which is super, super important. If you don't know who you are, then you don't know what you're capable of, and then operating in that authority that Christ has given you is super, super important. We went on into the second session. I've got so many sticky notes and pages all over the place, so this might be kind of hard to figure out. Your place of authority, being that Jesus gives all believers power and authority over the devil and his cohorts, and he has restored what Adam lost and more. And that's super important. We have dominion and authority over everything on the earth. Knowing that we have that power and dominion over these things and actually walking it out, not in our own ability, but in the ability and the authority that Christ has given us is important. So when we say that you are in Christ, that means that you are operating under the authority of Christ and you have total authority over the enemy. Getting to that point where you understand that completely in your mind or willing to walk it out is key. Session three was dormant gifts. We talked about how the gifts that you're given when you were saved and you were given the authority of Christ, that they can't lay dormant. You have to exercise those things. You cannot neglect them at all. The gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on in the hands of the eldership. That comes out of 1 Timothy 4:14. Let's see. We talked about being intimidated by those who are older than us, simply by the example they need to see by being faithful and true in all that they do. You must speak the truth and live a life of purity and authentic love as you remain strong in the faith. That is the Passion Translation in 1 Timothy 4:12. Lesson four was the intimidation is a spirit, understanding that intimidation, that fear is only coming from the enemy. That is not God ordained. That does not come from him. It never does, never will. So if you have fear in your life, it's not coming from him. Now, in this last lesson, we're going to talk about fear, but the fear that brings intimidation does not come from the Lord. All right? In lesson four, he talks about intimidation of the spirit. It says a person exercises witchcraft when they assume a place of authority in order to control or manipulate others. Leave that alone, Diane. That will be for tomorrow evening.
Yeah.
Lesson five, paralyzed by intimidation. So that is absolutely something that many, many face is being paralyzed by this intimidation. It's the fear that, you know, fear of exposure or, you know, that oppression that's put on us by the enemy. Those things are real, and you have to face those and you know, really address those things. My wife and her amazing projects. She's doing very well. She's ready to, she's probably about ready to fall asleep right now. She's tired. But he said this in lesson five, an intimidated person honors what they fear more than they honor God. That is an amazing, that is a very strong statement. I'll say that again. An intimidated person honors what they fear more than they honor God. That's where you come into, okay, do you understand who you are in Christ, your identity, and then walking that identity out. They compromise what they know to be right while allowing what they, under other circumstances, would not tolerate. This study was very interesting. It opened up some really good eyes, I think. Lesson six was stirring up the gifts. God must be our source of strength alone, and true boldness comes from God and is fueled by the virtues of love, power, and soundness of mind, which is the basis of 2 Timothy 1:7. When we try to be bold on our own strength, it is often a mask of arrogance and ignorance. Let me say that again. When we try to be bold in our own strength, it is often a mask for arrogance and ignorance. You can tell somebody who has the confidence in the Lord, and Todd White used to call it Godfidence. You know, when you have confidence, you can. It's a different flavor of confidence, and you normally can have the discernment that somebody is very confident in the Lord. They're not confident in their own ability because they'll be humbled, but they'll also operate in authority. I think that's probably the key to that. See, lesson seven, we talked about the root of intimidation. The possessing of a spirit of timidity or fear has nothing to do with a deficiency in personality, physical strength, or anointing. When the pressure becomes strong enough, what you're made of will be exposed. That's that, I always used to call it like the Gideon's wine press. When you would get in there, when you were squeezed, when you were put under pressure, what's in you will come out. So if you have been filled with the Spirit and you are constantly feeding that, and I remember somebody did a visual one time. I think it was Pastor Jesse. It's like this giant tube, and it had a bunch of water in it. It had a bunch of ping pong balls, and the ping pong balls represented like sin. And he would pour the water in there, and all that stuff would come out. Well, the water, of course, represented the Holy Spirit. And when you were full, there's no room. When you're full of the Holy Spirit all the time, there's no room for anything else. That doesn't mean I won't try. Desire is not enough. The heart is willing, but the flesh is weak. God's love is what will motivate us to lose our life. So when we understand that we must give up our life in order to save our life for eternity, that's when we'll start moving in the right direction. Let's see. All right. Do we have any questions? I know that was a kind of a quick summary. All of the lessons are available on our YouTube link if you need that, or if you know somebody that needs it and wants to listen to this study, let me know and I can send it out. I sent it out to everybody about a week ago once I finally processed all the other sessions that we had. But all seven of them are on there. So today we're going to talk about two types of fear. And he says this, you will serve whom you fear. If you fear man more than you fear God, you will become a slave to man. But if you fear God more than man, you'll obey God even at the rejection or disapproval of man. That is important. Why do we do the things that we do? Are we doing it for a pat on the back or to please somebody else? If your only goal in life is to please God, then you are probably in a pretty good place. And you will please lots of other people that are important that God has put around you when you put him first. We kind of go back to that triangle. If you put him at the top and you're always putting him first, you're heading in the right direction. There's a couple things he talks about, and he'll go into a little bit in the video, but there's two things that I want to share real quick, and they're I'll share the scriptures on them. But there's two things that talks about fear, that the beginning of wisdom and the beginning of knowledge. And it talks about in Psalm 111, verse 10, it says this, The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. And if we go, that's the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And then in Proverbs 1:7, and it's in multiple places too. But in Proverbs 1:7, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. So we're talking about two things. We're talking about wisdom, and we're talking about knowledge. And he's going to go into depth in that in this study. So I just want to kind of give you a precursor to that. And it says, like I said, for Proverbs 1:7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Now, once we get into this, he's going to talk about not serving two masters, but we'll get into this a little bit more after the video. Does anybody have any questions concerning the two types of fear that we're going to get into or any of the previous lessons we kind of just summarized? No? Okay. I am going to share this, and I'm going to attempt to only hear the audio. Can you all see that screen? Can you guys see that?
Yes.
Okay. I'm trying to cut out all the background noise. Maybe this is the last lesson I've finally figured it out, but.
On behalf of the entire team here at Messenger International, we are so excited that you are going through the Breaking Intimidation course. Look, so many people struggle to move forward in their callings because of fear, but here's what we know. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so if someone you know is struggling with fear or intimidation, we encourage you, share this message with them as well. Because here's the cool thing, someone else gave so that you could enjoy this course at no cost. And now we want to give you the opportunity to do the exact same thing. See, we believe that you are a messenger, and it's only through you that we can take this message into the hands of everyone everywhere. See, every time you give, you are a part of fulfilling Jesus's final command that he gives us in Matthew 28 that says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. So we're so excited as you continue to learn and to grow into all that God has for you. If you want more information on this topic, you can visit our related resources or check out all the other courses that we have here on Messenger X. We hope you enjoy this final lesson, and thanks again for your support, because everyone deserves to know.
All right, we're in the final lesson. I'm so proud of all you guys for staying with this course. And let me just mention, I'm going to cover a lot of material. I'm going to skim it briefly. I think about 3 chapters worth of material. I highly advise that you get the book, Breaking Intimidation, but it's not required, okay? So let's start out with our scripture, 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of intimidation, but a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of a sound mind. Now we're going to talk about sound mind in this final lesson. A sound mind is one that possesses the knowledge and wisdom of God in any given situation. Write that down. A sound mind is when you know what God wants in any situation, all right? This produces great confidence, boldness, all right? Nothing is more intimidating than being ignorant, not knowing what to do. This is why Paul says, don't be ignorant of the will of God. It's so important. Knowledge is so valuable. The knowledge of God's will is so, so valuable. We read in Proverbs, a wise man is strong. See, wisdom gives you strength. Knowledge gives you strength. Yes, a man of knowledge increases strength. Through knowledge, the righteous will be delivered. And God says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Wisdom is extremely valuable. We read in Proverbs chapter 4, getting wisdom is the most important thing you can do. Whatever else you get, get insight. Love wisdom, and she will make you great. See, God has no problem with you being great when he makes you great, and his wisdom will. So Knowledge and wisdom produces a confidence. How do we get knowledge? How do we get wisdom? And I'm not talking about just ordinary knowledge. I'm not talking about ordinary wisdom. I'm talking about the knowledge of God and the wisdom of God. How do we get it? It's very simple. The fear of the Lord. Psalm 111 verse 10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments." Proverbs 1:7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." I'll never forget a very successful businessman. Well, actually, he has a commercial construction company, one of the best in California. And he spent a lot of time in the Word of God, and he said it was amazing. When I went on the job site, I just knew what to do. I said, "Do this, do that, do this." He said, "I was almost in awe of how I knew the right thing to do." He has the fear of the Lord. There are two types of fear. There is the fear of the Lord, and there is the fear of man. Of course, the fear of man is intimidation. The only way to walk totally free from intimidation is to walk in the fear of God. So, what is the fear of God? It is when we esteem Him, we reverence Him, we highly value what He values. We love what He loves. We hate what He hates. We don't dislike what He hates. We hate what He hates. Okay? Now, let me make this clear. God loves people. So if somebody hates people, they don't fear God because they hate what He loves. God hates sin that unmakes people. See, the fear of God hates the sin that unmakes people. But the fear of the Lord loves people. We love what He loves. We hate what He hates. We hold what is important to Him as important to us. What is not so important to Him is not so important to us. We obey His word instantly. We obey His word when it doesn't make sense sometimes. We obey His word to completion. And the Bible says in Proverbs 14:26, in the fear of the Lord, there is strong confidence. So there's where that holy fear, which produces the knowledge of God, which produces a sound mind, here comes your boldness. Here comes your confidence. What is the fear of man? To fear man is to stand in alarm, anxiety, awe, dread, and suspicion, cowering before mortal men. When entrapped by this fear, we will live on the run, hiding from harm and reproach, and constantly avoiding rejection and confrontation. Afraid of what man can do to us, we will not give God what He deserves. The fear of the man, Proverbs says, listen carefully, the fear of man brings a snare. A snare is a trap. What is the trap? The trap is you give up your God-given authority. We read in Isaiah 51, verse 7 through 13, "Listen to me, you who know righteousness, you people whose heart is my law. Do not fear the reproach of men, nor be afraid of their insults." Who are you? I love this. Who are you that you should be afraid of man who will die, and the son of man who will be made like grass, and forget the Lord your Maker? Wow, what a statement. Paul made this statement in Galatians 1:10, "For if I still please men, I would not be the bondservant of Christ." If you look at King David and King Saul, and I talk about this extensively in the book, there is a picture of a man who fears God and a man who doesn't. King Saul was told by the word of the Lord not to offer the sacrifice for 7 days until Samuel offered it. But he was fighting the Philistines. They had thousands of foot soldiers and thousands of chariots. And his men were so afraid they were going AWOL. Every day, Saul's army got smaller and smaller. Every day, the Philistines' army got more powerful and larger. What did King Saul do? He offered the sacrifice. He disobeyed the word of God because he didn't want to lose any more soldiers. He didn't want them defecting. Samuel came after he did it and said, "You have done something so foolish. You have honored what you feared more than you have honored God's word." And he lost his kingdom as a result. This fear of man was evident when God told him to utterly destroy the Amalekites. But he spared the king. Why did he spare the king? Because the king would be a living trophy in his palace. It would always remind Saul of his conquest of the Amalekite nation. He spared the best sheep and the best animals when God said, "Kill them all," because the people wanted those best sheep. So even though it was a religious thing, he disobeyed the word of the Lord. And as a result, he lost his kingdom. If you look at David, David went through a much harder situation than Saul did. Saul's men were going AWOL, but the ones, the few that were left with him, the few thousand that were left with him, were still supporting him. But if you look at David, David has 600 men that are left on the earth that really believe in him. And he has been in the wilderness, in the deserts, and in the land of the Philistines for 12 years. He decides to go to battle with the Philistines. The Philistine leaders reject him. They go back to Ziklag, where David and his 600 men had their wives and families, and the Amalekites had come in and raided that town of Ziklag, took all the men's wives, all the children as hostage. They kidnapped them and took all their valuables. David's men were so upset, they wanted to stone him. But you know, David doesn't say, guys, we'll go after them. David first inquires of the Lord. This is something you're going to see about David all throughout 1 Samuel. He inquires of the Lord. He inquires of the Lord. He inquires. He always wanted to know what is the will of God, because that gave him a sound mind. Let me say this in closing. Seven times God says to Joshua, before he goes in and he takes the promised land, he says, be strong and of good courage. What is the opposite of courage? A lot of people say it's fear. No, put a dis in front of it, discourage. Let me tell you why God said to Joshua seven times to be strong and of good courage. Because 40 years earlier, 12 leaders went into the promised land. And 12 leaders came back, and 10 of them had a bad report. They saw how big the giants were in the promised land. And what they saw was the size of the giants and the fortified cities and the weapons that they had. They didn't see the size of the God they served. And so they brought back a bad, an evil report. They said, we are not able to go in and conquer this promised land. And because of it, they turned the hearts of millions of people to not obey God. I'll never forget when a pastor said to me one day, John, would you rather speak to 10 leaders or to 3 million people? I said, 3 million people. He said, you chose wrong. He said, because 10 leaders turned the hearts of 3 million people. I went, wow. I realized how important leadership was. And so here's a leader getting ready to bring the next generation into that promised land. And God says seven times, either through Moses, through the elders, or directly to Joshua, be strong and of good courage. Why? That you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you to do, and not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, so that you may prosper wherever you go. You know what's interesting? God doesn't command Joshua to be strong and courageous, to have great wars and to make great conquests. He says, be strong and courageous to keep the word of God. I think sometimes it's harder to obey the word of God than it is the pressures that come on us, like that came on King Saul, or the pressures that the 10 spies felt, the pressures to not obey the word of God and go what would protect and self-preserve them. You know, there's a definition to courage that I love, and this is out of the Webster's Dictionary. It's the attitude or response of facing and dealing with anything recognized as difficult, dangerous, or painful instead of withdrawing from it. You know, there may be times that God's word to you may cause you to go into a very difficult situation, maybe even a painful situation. The question is, are you going to obey God, or are you going to allow self-preservation to pull you back? When you have the knowledge of God and you have the love of God fueling it, and you realize you have the power of God to overcome in any situation, you will never be intimidated. This is the way to walk totally free from intimidation. So, in closing, I want to say this. I want to pray for you. I want to pray that the spirit of intimidation is broken off of your life. God hasn't given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. I want you to begin to operate in what God has placed in your heart. So if you say, hey, John, I have lived under a spirit of intimidation, let's you and I break that together right now. I'm going to stretch my hand towards you. I want you, as a point of contact on your computer, on your phone, wherever you're watching me, put your hand right on my hand and let's agree together that this spirit is broken. Remember, It is a spirit, and you have to address it in the realm of the spirit. So in the name of Jesus, I'm going to lead you in a prayer of repentance to God, and then we're going to break that spirit. I want you to say this. In the name of Jesus, Father, forgive me for tolerating what Jesus paid such a high price for to deliver me from. You spirit of intimidation, I give you no more place in my life, but I command you in the name of Jesus to go from my life, from my home, and from my family, and from my ministry, from my life, from my job. I give you no place any longer, but I command you in the name of Jesus to be gone. And Father, I am asking you now to fill me with a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of a sound mind. There it is, in Jesus' name. You have broken it. And let me say this to you, don't succumb to it any longer. I mean, don't. God spoke this to me when I really understood intimidation. He said, son, why do you walk right back into, in your lifestyle, what you prayed to be free from? And I realized that you have to live in that high calling. You abide in that high calling. Don't allow intimidation to come anymore. You can recognize it by the symptoms of discouragement, depression, fear. Man, when you sense that coming around, you ask the Holy Spirit, is it an intimidating spirit I need to address? There were many, many times I had to address it after I got free, but then the day came. I guess that spirit realized I recognized it too quickly, and I took the sword of the Spirit, just like you and I just did, and I bound it. That's what you need to continue to do. And like I said, I would get the book. I would go through it over and over again. Why? To develop your faith, to break that spirit when we're not on camera and we're not praying together. You break it. You take authority over it, and you ask for it in fresh infilling of the Spirit of God, the Spirit of power, the Spirit of love, and the Spirit of a sound mind. I am so honored that we've been able to take this journey together, and I'm so excited about what's going to happen with you from this time forward. You're going to be more fruitful in the workplace, in the marketplace, in the educational field, in healthcare, wherever it is God has you, whether you're a single mom at home, whether your parents raising a family, you are going to have the blessings of God overflowing in your life, in your family, and in your business because you broke that ugly spirit. I am so proud of you, and I love you very much. God bless you.
Hello. Pretty powerful, huh?
Yes, that was.
good culmination to bring it all together too. That's good. So let's get into this a little bit. There's a lot of meat here. The big thing, so we talked about a sound mind is the result of possessing the knowledge and wisdom of God in any given situation. So he backed those scriptures up, and I kind of get that in the beginning. The beginning of wisdom was from Psalm 111, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and then the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. So having those two things is important. That fear is we've talked about it in the past, that it's not like the scary fear, the intimidation. It's the fear of the Lord is the not wanting to be far away from Him. There's a difference between fear and reverent fear, and he didn't really go into that much, but I always look at that from that perspective, that if I have a reverent fear of the Lord, I just don't want to be away from Him. I just want to stay as close to Him as I can. Not because I'm fearful out there, but when I know that I'm close to Him and I'm in Christ and I stay in Christ, then I have full authority. And when I can walk out full authority, then things start to flee. Things start to tremble when that comes. You know, that's that spirit of that was in Peter and John when they walked in, and their shadows started healing people and started causing the demons to flee just because of their shadows were coming in. So I think that's important. He talked about this. He said, it is not enough to just have an in-depth knowledge of the scriptures. You must also hear what God's Spirit is presently saying. So in order to hear what God's Spirit is presently saying, you have to, like he said, inquire of the Lord. He talked about that in David. That comes out of 2 Samuel, I think, 2 Samuel 18, 19, where he's battling the Philistines and he inquires of the Lord. He inquires of the Lord two different times. I think we talked about that maybe a couple weeks ago. When he inquires of the Lord, each time that you inquire the Lord, instead of just going on what he gave you last time, you have to do it again because his plans and processes for your next victory could be different than the last time. So you need to make sure, we all need to make sure that we're inquiring of the Lord in every given situation, every battle that we face. And I don't know anybody that does that. Miss Sue's probably one of the better ones. Frank's probably one of the better ones. But they have a lot more wisdom than we do. But we like to learn from them. Yeah, I swear, every time you get into something, one of these questions that comes up, it'll say, you know, how is that evident in your life? And, you know, I have to go, yeah, I knew. It's like when you go into a situation and you come up with a really good punchline, but you don't come up with it till after you've left the situation. You're like, oh man, if I would have just said this, it would have been so funny. But it's too late. I kind of look at that, you know, inquiring of the Lord that way too. So if you inquire of the Lord before the situation, then it'll be all good. Anyway, there's a couple of questions. He's got three questions in here. It says, there are two types of fear, the fear of God and the fear of man. Which one do you tend to do more? Which one do you fear more, the fear of God or do you fear man? It says, what evidence in your life supports this? So let's look at this real quick. So who do you tend to fear more, man or God? And does the actions in your life, are they evident of who you fear more? Anybody? I mean, anybody can go.
I used to have a tremendous fear of man, what people think of me, mm-hmm. you know, for years. I think I was kind of brought up that way. It was very important that people not think ill of you or, you know, your name was very important to, you know, to keep right, keep clean. And it was just something that's always been there in my life. And, you know, fear of failure, you know, just tremendous fear of failure, you know, of not living up to that perfect person, you know, that the family thinks you are or should be, you know. And I'm just so thankful that he took that out of me in the last month or so, that it I can't even describe that freedom to walk or to live with not having that fear or that intimidation, you know, of just the situations around, you know. And you're talking about wisdom, you know, that wisdom, it seems like, has always been something I have prayed for a lot, but it always seems, I never feel like I have it. I never feel like I have enough, you know. I never feel like, I fear God. I fear him. I believe in my heart above anything else. But, now, I was listening to that funeral today. And, you know, listening to all the accolades, you know, of this love, you know, and Pastor White brought that out. Without love, we don't have anything. We can have all the faith, and we can have, you know, to move a mountain, you know, we can prophesy, you know, we can have all these things, you know, but if we don't love, you know, and this woman really loved her family and loved people, you know, and it's easy to look. Sometimes I think at other people's lives, and you know, your life don't even come that much close to measuring up to that other person's life. And you think, you know, Lord, where did I mess up? You know, Lord, what did I do wrong? You know, you know, you just hope and pray that there's something in your life, you know, that your family will see Jesus, that your family will know that they are loved, mm-hmm. and that you do care about them. And it's just, I always feel so lacking in that area. You know, my grandmother to me was always such a woman of wisdom. You know, she always seemed to have the right answer, you know, for whatever the situation was. And she loved her family. She loved people so much, and young people, she loved them and they loved her back, you know, and I just saw so much of that in her, and always wanted to have wisdom, you know, to be able to give a right answer, you know, at, in that situation. And so many times, I don't know if it's the day we live in, but you can give people God's word, you can tell them, and they don't want to hear it. You know, they get so angry and so defensive. And, you know, you just wonder, you know, how to go to get beyond that. But then God places other people in your life. You know, he's given me many daughters, many grandmothers, many others, you know, feel that love for and feel that love too, and it's given and back and forth, you know, but it's like your own family. You know, a lot of times they don't want to hear it. Mm-hmm. You know, and but you know, he says if the family turns away, you know, it's like the wedding feast, you know, then you go out and he'll bring the strangers in, you know, he'll bring others in, you know, that are willing to hear the truth, and that is willing to hear his word, and that is willing to love, you know, and want to respond. And little Rachel is one of them. And I'm so thankful that God has put her in my life, in our lives, not just mine, but our lives, you know, and I'm so thankful for this. You know, but it seems like sometimes, you know, the ones that are closest to you, and I know Saul went through that, David went through that. I mean, you know, his son tried to kill him and overthrow his throne, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many more people that's gone through so much, much more than we in our little lives have ever been through, you know. And, but I just ask God for wisdom. And the boldness and the courage to speak it, you know, when it needs to be done.
So I'm almost running out of ink because I'm writing down lots of things that I'm hearing. So right now I have four things for you, Sue. So you talked about wisdom. I have a question because I know you have wisdom. So when you pray for wisdom, is it similar to praying for patience? You know, I mean, really, I don't know. I don't know if there's a right answer to that, but I kind of look at it like that. I mean, you know, I think wisdom is gained with experience. It's gained with time and trust and having faith in him to endure to the end. You know, it talks about, Paul talked about running this race until the end, you know.
Yes, sir.
You talked about your grandmother, you know, always having the right answer and always just loving people. Well, when you were saying that, I could kind of feel the Spirit saying that your grandmother is very proud of you because you are a direct reflect of her. So the things that she showed you by example, you do the same thing. Anybody that knows you or even just meets you knows that you are just like a wellspring of love, and that there's no judgment in you, that you treat everybody in the same manner, just as Christ did. So don't ever question that. So if you're questioning any of that, that is absolutely the enemy trying to break you down. He's trying to thwart what the Lord is doing to you. Yeah. Another thing is, is influence. So you talked about your family and how you try to share Christ with them. Well, that's really all we can do. So we have either positive or negative influence on other people. What they choose to do is on them. All we can do is influence them. Anything outside of influencing somebody in a positive nature, if we try to force them to do it, that's called slavery, and that's what Jesus came to abolish, right? So he came to abolish all that stuff. So as an influencer, I believe that we're all in that position to where we can continually grow our influence or strengthen our influence by being strong and courageous, just like Joshua said. You know, I don't know anybody that can't attest to the fact that you are a major, major Jesus influencer everywhere you go. And the other thing about that is this. So even Jesus could not do things in his hometown because of familiarity.
Oh, sure. So go ahead and preach that.
Don't let family keep you from just continuing to do what Christ wants to do in you. Because you're an influence. They see that. Look at Bella. We just all watched this while you were sharing your heart. Bella, what did she come up to you? She didn't come up to you nagging you and this and that. She came up to you and gave you a kiss.
Yeah.
That's because of the love that you pour on her all the time. That's because of the influence that you have over her. She's in your realm of influence. And you do exactly what your grandmother did to you, and you're passing it on. And there may come a day when you'll see it. There may come a day when you'll see it from heaven. The same thing's happening in her. You know what I mean? So don't feel bad that you try with your family so much, because like you said, Jesus, it said that it wasn't that he couldn't perform miracles in his hometown. It's just that they didn't want to hear it because he was just that old carpenter dude.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? So
yes.
So don't let that. I just felt like Laura was saying, don't let that keep you from doing exactly what you know to do, because you know, you know. You know in your heart of hearts. Your knower knows exactly what he wants you to do. And when you don't, then you ask.
Yes, sir.
Because we know that you do. Not that any of us hears you asking him, but it's evident in your life and how you live your life. It's evident in your character. You know?
Wow.
You are all of our mother, some of us. Some of them, grandmother, sister, you know, all those things. So I just want to encourage you that you are a major Jesus influencer, and the spirit of love is absolutely overflowing from you at every given turn. So anything that comes against that, get behind me, Satan.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. I think the fear of man, I think we could really, I know that you fear God, but when you get in these difficult situations, especially with family, the fear of man does seem prevalent at times, you know, because they've known you at your worst. They've, you know, they see what goes on behind closed doors type of thing. So, you know, I can see where it's a little harder to fight that fear of man there, or to be intimidated, but it's, you know, it's family.
I think that's with all families too, don't you agree? I mean,
yeah.
Because they've seen you when you're a heathen and when you know, I mean,
right.
So that's where the judgment comes in, and you know.
Yeah. But again, Jesus had the same problem, you know, when it came to his own family.
Thank you, John. Appreciate that.
Yes, ma'am. Just being obedient.
Everybody talks about Sister Sue.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're a hero to many.
I don't understand that because I don't feel that way.
Yep. And that's good. That's good. So that's pure heart right there. That's the enemy don't want you to see that part.
Yeah, I don't feel that way many times. I do not. You know, it's just like, why would even people think that about me? You know, why would they even say that? You know, because I feel I cannot do anything within my own self. You know, it's like I always felt like I'm the weakest link in the family. You know, I'm the weakest I'm the youngest. I was the weakest, you know. Even my middle sister, when she passed away, she told her daughter, she said that she wanted me there because I was the strongest one. And I'm not, you know, but I couldn't believe that. And God made it that way. I was the only one with her when she passed. And she only wanted me with her when she passed because she knew I could handle it. And I thought, why would she think such a thing, you know? But God did. He gave me strength to get through that and to handle it, you know. But, and I guess, you know, sometimes people see things in you that you just don't see. And I don't see it. A lot of times I don't see that in me, but I want people to see Jesus. I want people to know that they are loved and they are cared about regardless, you know, but I've never seen that in me. And it's just hard for me to comprehend that, you know.
Sister Sue, I just got an epiphany from the Lord. That you know how you felt during that service, homegoing service today, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, it could have been you laying in that casket and you that they were talking about, and it would have been very, very befitting for the service to have been exactly the same.
Absolutely.
Well, I appreciate that. But see, it, in my mind, it's just hard for me to imagine such things. Right. But
you're your own worst enemy, sister.
We all.
You are well loved, and I can tell you, you know, just the time that we've been in ministry together, I can't tell you how many people always bring you into the equation, especially if they need prayer or whatever.
Well, I thank you because it is only through Jesus.
Absolutely.
That.
But he's all over you, and that's what people see in you. They're not seeing Sue. They are seeing Jesus.
Yep.
That's my prayer. That's what I want them to see. You know, mm-hmm. I just don't see that part of me a lot of times, you know, but because I know the human part of us is weak, you know, and you know, that's just my heart's desire is to just let them see him, you know, and not see that weak part.
Yeah, but that's where your strength comes from. So your humbleness in itself, your humbleness in itself is where your strength comes from. You're not weak. There's Sue, Wayne and Diane can attest to this. Susan and I can attest to this. There's many times that we've been around you, and there's been some times where you felt weak. But I can assure you that the Jesus in you was living so strongly that it's not weakness at all.
Nope.
Yep.
And that's the reason probably why you don't see that. It's not. Because if we were to see us in that light, I think that it would probably start to maybe have the breeding ground for pride to rise back in. And that's not, there's no room for that in you. There's no room for pride when you were, and there's no room for pride because you're so humble. That's the direct opposite.
Yep. Right.
And in humbleness, that's where you gain strength. He said he desires a broken and contrite heart. That's you.
It has to be him. It has to be him. Yes, sir.
You're definitely a nice, nice, clean Windex glass. Transparent.
And you're bold because when it comes right down to it and people need something or whatever, you are on it. Like, no, that is not who you are. That's not who the Lord says you are. And no, you're not going to talk like this. I mean, there's a boldness that comes out of you through him,
mm-hmm.
you know, that you turn their way of thinking and you don't give up on it. I mean, you grill it in them because it needs to be grilled in.
Who knows?
That's you stepping in your authority in him. And it's powerful. It's mm-hmm. believable.
Yeah, because I know it's true. I know he's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did. Anybody else?
Other than the fear of a man, he said the fear of man equals intimidation. So if you are feeling intimidated, then that's your clue right there that's the fear of man in you. What else did he say? It brings a...
That's the litmus test for sure.
That's where you get it. That's where you get caught up in a trap.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because you're giving up your God-given authority in him.
That it brings a snare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man brings a snare.
Right. And it causes you to give up your God-given authority. So that should be our clue immediately mm-hmm. to take a hold of that and turn mm-hmm. in the opposite direction.
Right. Yeah, that's where the boldness
rises. Don't partner with
yeah.
it. And, yeah. Go the yeah. other way.
I love it. He said that David always inquired of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. he inquired of the Lord, no matter what circumstances. Lord, and I love that. I love that.
Yeah, I want to say it's 2 Samuel. No, maybe 1 Samuel. All right, the next thing is this. He said, in whom are you placing your confidence, yourself or your own reasoning, or in God and his word? How often do you seek God's direction when making decisions? This kind of goes back into inquiring of the Lord, and I mean, my answer was definitely not often enough. I don't inquire enough. You get complacent sometimes and just forget, you know, and then afterwards you're like, oh man, I should have asked him first. You know, now I'm in this situation, and I'm going to have to walk it out because I didn't ask first.
Yeah.
yeah.
That reminds me of Lee Tate one time. He was, y'all know who Lee Tate was, I think. He preached a little bit at Milligan back in the day. But one thing I always remember, he said, before I buy a pair of shoes, I ask the Lord because I need those pair of shoes to last me a long, long time. And I thought, man, that's weird. Ask for a pair of shoes, you know? But that was his thing. He did. He inquired of the Lord about even the little snippet of things that you think's not important.
Buy a car, buy a house.
Yeah, but he's talking about a pair of shoes.
Mm-hmm.
I can see a big ticket item, you know what I mean? But a pair of shoes?
I do the same thing, Diane. When I'm buying shoes, I'm always praying because I have such a hard time finding shoes that fit my feet right.
Yeah.
I'm always praying. Let me find that, and he does, and usually gives me a really good deal on the pair I get.
mm-hmm.
It works.
Absolutely.
It works.
Well, I think we figured that one out. We don't ask him often enough, but we should ask him more often. But last one is this. What was the reason God repeatedly commanded Joshua to be strong and courageous? Why must you also be strong and courageous? I think it was important too. So I think it's in Joshua 3 when it talks about he's getting ready to lead the people into the Jordan River. And you know, it says that the Lord reminded him 7 times to be strong and courageous. Of course, the number 7 is the number of completion. But yeah. Why did he tell him so many times? I think that it was important because John discussed this too, because the leadership, Joshua was a leader. He was an influencer. He was there 40 years earlier as one of the 12 spies. He was one of 2 that came back, you know, strong and said, no, we can overtake them. You know, he wasn't one of the spineless ones that came back and were so scared of the grasshoppers, you know. But he was in a place of influence. And the thing that was interesting to me always was in Joshua 3 when he talks about as they're getting ready to enter to cross the Jordan into the promised land, which... You know, it was him that was doing it because I always get this wrong. Moses, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Moses didn't lead the people in the promised land because of pride.
Yes.
Because, you know, he got mad and smote the rock because he's mad at people. You know, but it talks about in Joshua 3, in Joshua 3, 5, he says, "And Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." The thing that was always interesting to me, especially in the first 10 chapters of Joshua, was that before they entered the Jordan, everything was very critical. Like, you had to sanctify yourself. You had to do this. You had to set up the 12 stones. It was very strategic, and it was very pure in order to enter to cross in the promised land. And he did that. His leadership brought them to that. And he was an example for that. I think that the reason why is because the people followed him into there, and they had to be very very clean and very sanctified in order to do that. But that wouldn't have happened had he ever had discouragement. Like John said, the opposite of courage is to be discouraged. He led the people because he was strong and courageous, because he was, he showed that 40 years earlier with the 12 spies that he was strong. He was courageous. He was not afraid to go against what the other spies said. And then he stayed with Moses the entire part of his ministry, all through the wilderness. And then him and Aaron, the only two that crossed over into the promised land. So you had, in order to be able to do that, to endure all that, the Lord had to reiterate to him that you have to be strong and courageous. I think that was.
Don't you think it was also a warning too?
Yeah, I think it was too. I think that everything that the Lord tells us is for both sides.
Like, it's not going to be easy. You've got to push through, but you got to be strong. You have to be courageous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I believe that in God, He that's where the authority comes in. That's where the confidence comes in. That's where the lack of intimidation comes in. But the growth of experience and the growth of influence amongst the people, there's no, what's the word I'm looking for? There's no complacency in that. You can't just go all willy nilly and, well, I'm just going to go in the promised land because, Joshua's here and I'm following him, but, I got this little thing behind me. Look at what happened. If you keep reading in Joshua, it talks about after they've gone in the, I think it's Joshua. Well, Joshua 6 talks about the destruction of Jericho. And then if you look, I think that the call on the Lord for him to be strong and courageous, he had to bring that back up after the Battle of Jericho, when he had to confront the camp after the Battle of Ai and there being weakness in the camp. And if he didn't have that strong leadership at that point, he wouldn't have been able to address it, and there would have been more that died. So that's a lot going into Joshua. So if it doesn't make much sense, please go and start reading Joshua. It is an amazing, amazing book. There's 24 chapters, I think, but amazing book, especially talking about being confident and God-fident. Joshua's one of my favorite characters in the book anyway, so sorry, I'm a little biased.
Hey, Sean.
Yes.
The Lord said that he's giving them that promised land. They're not going to have to go in there and worry or anything about it. Joshua believed, and God said, I'm giving it to you, so why should I not go in there? Why should I be afraid of the giants or anybody else? I just want to trust God and believe God, because he said, I am giving it to you, so go. Don't have any reservations.
Yeah. Well, 10 out of the 12, don't you think the 10 out of the 12 that went back with the bad report had the fear of man, because that's what they were looking at?
Yes, that's the point. What were they seeing? They weren't seeing the fruit.
Now they weren't trusting God.
No.
Because God said, I'm giving it to you. But instead of keeping their eyes on God, they put their eyes on everything else but him. And they were afraid and they were intimidated.
Amen.
Except for Joshua and what was it, Caleb?
Yep.
Yep. They believed what God said. Nothing was going to stop them from going in there. They weren't going to be fearful. They were just going to do it, believe what God said. And that's what we have to do. We have to believe what God says and do what he says.
They weren't looking at the giant men. They were looking at the giant provision that the Lord had on that spike that they were carrying across with that fruit that they could barely carry.
That's right.
That was their provision. They knew what he was going to do. Man.
The word that kept coming to mind to me when he was talking about being strong and courageous was the word, the reason why he needed to be strong and courageous was it was imperative. And then I looked up during the video, I looked up imperative, and it says that the definition for imperative is vital importance or crucial, and it's giving an authoritative command.
Wow.
When that command was given by the Lord, Joshua had two choices. You either take a hold of it and you take a hold of it good and strong, or you disregard it. And Joshua chose correctly, I believe. And he had to. And like Diane said, I think that the warning, I mean, it was a kind of a precursor to go, this ain't gonna be easy, and you better have a hold of this thing. You know, so that's good. Anybody else?
He could have had a Moses moment and lost his right authority, and then he'd been like, he wouldn't have made it to the promised land either.
That's right. It says, speaking of that, that goes to the next thing. It says this in Joshua 1:7, it says, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. This is the key. I boxed it. Do not deviate. That means you don't go to the left, don't go to the right. Do not deviate. Be very critical on staying on the path. Then you will be successful in everything you do. If you don't deviate from his commandments and you just stay strict to them, you're going to prosper. Is it going to be tough at times? Yes, but you will prosper and you will see the success in things. It's when we get, the problem is when we go left and right. You know, we get distracted a little bit, you know. We get pulled off guard because our focus has shifted and gone towards something else. And that's when, you know, that's when we have to make sure that we keep focused. Dog on a track. One of the last things he talked about was in Philippians 3:14, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So that is the last of this study. If you haven't gotten the book or you want to get the book, you can go out there and get it. The previous studies that we went through this, those are available on YouTube. There's one last thing that he left us with, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But does anybody have any questions concerning this? I mean, I think that this has been a really good study as far as uncovering fear and intimidation and kind of facing things and really getting past it. Sue gave a really good testimony. I think it was about 2 weeks ago, how the Lord has really released her from this fear within the past, I think it's a month or so. And it was quite apparent that he did. So we're just continuing to pray that he'll strengthen that.
Yes.
As well. I know that many of us have seen Rachel really break out of that spirit of fear and intimidation. And, you know, she's gotten a boldness about her too. So Corey and Sarah as well, I know that they texted me a little while ago. They couldn't make it tonight, but them as well. So it's been good. I think that we need to make sure that we continue to stir up these gifts. We continue to address and inquire the Lord when we're faced with things. And anytime that stuff starts to come to us where we start feeling that pressure, you know, that some fear or intimidation is coming, that's their first sign to go, okay, I need to turn around and face this. And in Christ, I know that I can turn around and face this because he has the authority that lives in me to defeat this. It's not me, but it's him. So I think that's imperative.
Him and you, yep.
Mm-hmm. I think that's good. Does anybody have any questions or comments about this so far? Go ahead, Rachel.
It's been really good, and I don't want it to end.
All things have to come to an end temporarily. But
yeah.
Do you have the book?
Yeah, I can go back and study it because I need to. So.
Yeah, there's a lot in the book, too. So if you need the book, grab that. This was one of his really good studies. I like this one. So, anybody else? I want to thank you all for joining from week to week. We haven't had a lot, but I think It's not always the amount of people, but it's the quality. You know, we're continuing to come back. We're continuing to kind of dig into this and grow from it. So that's important. So I thank you for that. I'm going to leave you with this. This is the last thing that John says. He said he basically is taking and declaring a blessing over all of us that are studying this. He says, I declare I am strong and courageous. I obey God's word and I do not deviate from it. God makes me successful in everything I do. God is for me, and no one and nothing can stand against me. I press towards the prize of the upward call of God in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. All right, I appreciate y'all. If nobody else has any questions, I will let y'all go for the evening, and I will process this video, and then I'll send out a message that all the 8 sessions are available to anybody who would like them.
What's next and when?
I don't know yet. It'll probably be after the encounters. We'll probably start our next study. And the next study will, as far as I can tell right now, I'll continue to inquire the Lord. But I think that he wants me to do the study that he gave me. I just got to finish kind of putting it into a, format it into a curriculum type thing. But it'll be on identity, authority, and influence. And it'll be all scripture based. It'll be all scripture based. So it'll be definitely maybe do some homework type stuff so that we can come back and we can all be engaged in this. So I don't want to be the one talking the whole time, but I definitely have a lot that he's given me. It's about 15 pages right now. So
that's awesome. Yeah. That's four doors, man. The four doors is really what he's been having me teach, really, the ladies at Saving Grace, but you know, those four doors, which is, it's the door to fear, you know, and hatred and sexual abuse and the occult and witchcraft, you know, recognizing what different things fall under each category, really. But that's when you said identity, that's where my mind, you know, immediately went to.
Yep.
Because it's so powerful.
Yeah, you got to know who you are in Christ first, and then you got to know, okay, now that I know who I am, I got my name tag on, you know, what comes with that?
Yep, but you got to get rid of them old belief systems in order to know who you are in him.
Yep.
That's where your identity is going to come in, because you're basing your identity off really about from the age of 3, you know, and, but yeah.
I have a feeling it'll be a pretty long study, because I'm sure there'll be a lot of sozo.
A lot to talk about. There'll be a lot to talk about.
It'll be a long study, that's right.
Well, foundation of identity class I had in school was a long class.
For a reason.
Absolutely. Yep. That's, to me, that's the biggest thing right there.
Yeah.
The unforgiveness and the identity.
Once you get past those,
talking about wisdom and knowledge and all that, man.
Amen.
So good.
All righty. We love y'all.
Love you too.
I love y'all. Have a good night.
All right. Take care. Love y'all.